Good morning, friends. Welcome to the lecture of functional analysis. In the last lecture, we have seen the concept of functional and we have started proving the Hahn-Banach lemma. Let me just recall what is functional. Functional is a scalar valued, either real valued or complex valued continuous linear transformation defined on a normed linear space. Let me just share my screen. These are the lecture notes we have seen in the last lecture. We will just have a look on all the notes. Okay, this is functional. Functional, if I define a mapping F from a nonlinear space to either real or complex field, if it is a bounded linear transformation or continuous linear transformation, then it is called functional. And collection of all such a functionals are defined with the help of this set B of n comma r by c is denoted by n star and is called a conjugate space or dual space or the adjoint space. And then we have started proving the Hahn-Banach lemma. We will recall the statement for a linear subspace M of a nonlinear space N, if f is a linear functional defined on M for any point x naught not in M, M naught is a space spanned by M and x naught, then we want to prove that the functional small f can be extended to a functional f naught on capital M naught such that norm of f naught is equal to norm of f. This is what a situation. This is my small f, x naught be a point not in M. Then we have found one another linear subspace M naught which is spanned by M and x naught. F is a functional. Now we want to extend it to a functional f naught on M naught. Therefore, the element in the set M naught is of the type M plus alpha x naught. M is an element of M. Alpha be any scalar. This is the nature of element. W is equal to M plus alpha x naught. The proof we have started proving first for the field of real numbers. Therefore, f naught is a mapping we have defined on M naught. With this, f naught of omega is equal to f naught of m plus alpha x naught. M plus alpha x naught is a structure defined for this vector omega of the subspace M naught, which we have defined as f of m plus alpha r naught. In the last lecture, we have seen why we have defined this as f of m plus alpha r naught, because our aim is to prove that f naught is linear. If f naught would be linear, this will be f naught of m plus alpha into f naught of x naught. But f naught of m will be f of m on the linear subspace M because we want to prove f naught to be an extension. Therefore, by keeping all these points in mind, we have defined this as f of m plus alpha r naught. And then later we have started proving the first step that f naught is linear. Step by step, we have seen this in the last lecture. Next, we have seen that f naught is an extension. And in the third claim, we were proving norm of f naught is equals to norm of f. To prove this, we want to prove two different inequalities. Two inequalities going in opposite direction. First, norm of f naught greater equal by norm of f. Norm of f naught is less equal by norm of f. Out of this first one, we have proved. Okay. The first inequality we have proved with the help of just using a definition of operator norm. Norm f naught is equal to supremum mod of f naught of x. Instead of norm, we have used modulus because f naught is a scalar valued function. Therefore, either it is belonging to the field of real numbers or the field of complex numbers. And we know very well that the norm acting on both these fields is the modulus, right? That's why this is mod of f naught of x on the condition x belongs to m naught, norm x is less than or equals to 1. Now we want to change this underlined field, underlined subspace M naught to M. But we know M is a subspace of M naught. That's why the suprema will hold with greater equal inequality. That is, suprema over a superset is greater equal by suprema over its subset. Later, for the elements of M, we know F naught is equal to F because F naught we have proved to be an extension of M. And that's why the definition now becomes a supremum mod of f of x belongs to M, norm x is less than or equals to 1, and looking at this definition, we can easily say that this is norm of f. Therefore, first part of the inequality we have verified in the last lecture. Now, in today's lecture, we will go for the reverse part of the inequality. Therefore, what is the claim today to prove? In today's lecture, we want to prove that norm of f naught is less equal by norm of f. Okay. For this purpose, let us start with any two arbitrary vectors, say x1 and x2 of the linear subspace M. Okay. And consider the subtraction. What we want to consider, this is f of x2 minus f of x1. F of x2 minus f of x1. But as f is a functional, may I say f is linear. And using linearity property, one can write this as f of x2 minus x1 here. Therefore, this is f of x2 minus f of x1. Okay, now we can write this value is less equal by its modulus value. Mod of x2 minus x1. This is true for any scalar valued number or a function, that the number is less equal by its modulus, right? Now f is bounded. The function f we know as bounded because it is a functional. Therefore, using the definition of linear transformation to be bounded, may I write this as less equal by norm of f into norm of x2 minus x1. We will just recall, if the mapping t is bounded, we have written norm of t of x is less equal by norm of t into norm of x. The simple change here is, instead of norm of t of x, it is mod f of x. Why it is? Because f is a scalar valued function, either real valued or complex valued. That's why the norm acting on the spaces is modulus. Therefore, here instead of norm, we have modulus function. Means the statement is somewhat like this. The statement is mod of f of x is less equal by norm of f into norm of x. The only reason here is the norm acting on the real valued or complex valued fields is modulus. Therefore, we have just made use of the definition. Okay, let's come to the next page. This is f of x2 minus f of x1. Okay, now here we are going to make some small adjustment. We will try to add and subtract an vector x0. Therefore, let me write this as x2 plus x0 minus x1 plus minus x0. Just we have added this vector and subtracted the same. Okay, now we will try to collect the vectors x1 and x0 in one bracket, x2 and x0 in another bracket. Therefore, let me write this as in a bracket x2 plus x0, and here this is minus of x1 plus x0 in one bracket. Next step, this is less equal by. Now I just want to use a triangular inequality. Before using a triangular inequality, here we can write this as plus of minus of this bracket. Therefore, now we will use a triangular inequality, and the triangular inequality says that this is norm of x2 plus x0 added with norm of negative x1 plus x0. Okay. But we know very well that norm of a negative number, this negative is actually a scalar minus 1. That scalar can be taken out with a modulus, and the value of my modulus of minus 1 is plus 1. Therefore, we remain with only norm of x1 plus x0. Norm of x1 plus x0. Now let us multiply by norm of f. Therefore, this is norm of f into norm of x2 plus x0 plus norm f of x1 plus x0. To the left, we have fx2 minus fx1. Okay, now in next step, what we will do? We will just try to bifurcate the vectors with the terms x1 and x0 on one side, x2 and x0 on the another side. Therefore, what I will do here, the term with x1 and x0, we will shift it to the left, and this fx2, we will shift to the right one. Therefore, the inequality we have in our hand is, okay, this is minus fx1. This term we are shifting on the left. Therefore, this is minus norm of f into norm of x1 plus x0, less equal by this term we are shifting on the right. Therefore, this is with a negative. Therefore, this is minus fx2 added with norm f plus norm of x2 plus x0. Norm of x2 plus x0. Okay, now we can, as we have started with any arbitrary values x1 and x2 of the linear subspace M, means it is true for all the vectors in M. Now what the job we are going to do is, we are going to keep once the vector x2 on the right fixed. X0 is already fixed. We have just added and subtracted in between. Okay, if I fix x2 and vary the vectors x1 on the left side, then we may get different inequalities, rather infinite inequalities, where the right side is fixed. That is minus of x2 plus norm of x2 plus x0. Therefore, if we collect all the inequalities, all the values on the left to be in one set, may I say this minus of x2 plus norm f plus norm of x2 plus x0 will act as an upper bound, or the set will be bounded above. If the set is bounded above, we know that the suprema exists. Therefore, what will be the suprema? Suprema of that set must be less equal by this upper bound. Therefore, just let me write, this is supremum. Okay, for any arbitrary value we are writing, therefore let me change it to some f of y minus norm of f plus, sorry, not plus, here it is, into norm of y plus x naught. Okay, and the suprema is taken over y, which is a member of the subspace M. Okay, and this is as it is, right part. Means this right side will be an upper bound, and this will be the least upper bound. Suprema is the least upper bound, and the obvious relation between the least upper bound and upper bound is less equal. Thus, we have got this kind of inequality. Now, the same argument we will repeat by keeping x1 fixed and varying this vector x2 over the linear subspace M. Then what will happen if I vary this vector on the right for on the elements of capital M? Then this part of the inequality, left part of the inequality, will work as the lower bound. Okay, and if I write all the elements by varying the values of x2 in one bracket, then this set is bounded below. If it is bounded below, we know that infima exists. And what is the obvious relation between infima, between a lower bound and infima? Lower bound is less equal by the infima, because infima is my greatest lower bound. Therefore, here the quantity on the right, one can say this is infima. This is infima, or I can write it to the next line also. Therefore, on the next line, we have suprema minus f of y minus norm of f plus norm of y plus x naught is less equal by, on the right we can say infima exists, na? That's why this is infima minus f of y, infima minus f of y plus norm of f into norm of y plus x naught. No doubt suprema and infima are taken over any arbitrary vector y of the given set. Okay, you just please try to understand this inequality, because this is a very interesting part of the proof, right? Therefore, now here we have suprema of this kind of set, where y belongs to M, infim of this kind of set. Okay, here we check this is a real value, rather a scalar value, because f is scalar value, therefore this is a scalar. Norm f always scalar, norm of y plus x naught is always a scalar. Now as we are in the case of considering a real linear subspace, therefore all these are my real value. Therefore this bracket, suprema of the set is one real value, infima of the set is also a real value, and we know between two real values there always exists one real value in between due to the denseness of the set of real numbers. Therefore let us say, let me choose a real number, say r naught, such that this r naught lies between the suprema and infima value. Therefore let us just write suprema minus f of y minus norm of f plus norm of y plus x naught is less equal by r naught and is less equal by infima minus f of y plus norm of f into norm of y plus x naught. Therefore we have obtained a real value between the suprema and infima of both the sets, right? Now as this statement is true for arbitrary vector y in M, here also it is for an arbitrary vector y in M. So between suprema and infima there exists a this real number. Therefore may I say this real number r naught will lie between any arbitrary number of the set and any arbitrary number of this set also. Okay, if I want to give an example, let me just give an example how this lies between any two. Suppose we have a set on the left as 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Okay. And to the right, let me consider the set, suppose some 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. What is the suprema of the set? 5. What is the infima of the set? 7. Okay. Therefore, one can say that between suprema and infima of the set, there exists a real number, say r naught. Let me take the value to be some 6 value. Okay. Therefore, 6 is the number lying between suprema of the set and infima of this set. Therefore, may I say 6 lies between any arbitrary x of this set and any arbitrary y of this set. Right? Any arbitrary x of this set, that is y, that x may be 1, 2, 3, 4. Here that y may be any 8, 9, 10. Therefore, whichever the value we select, this value is going to lie between arbitrary element of the first set and arbitrary element of the second set as well. Okay, the same concept we will follow here. The same concept we will follow. What concept? R naught is the value. R naught is the value lies between suprema of this set and infima of this set. Therefore, R naught must lie between arbitrary value of this set and arbitrary value of this set. Therefore, let me just write R naught between the arbitrary value of the set. Therefore, minus f of y minus f of y minus norm of f plus norm of y plus x naught is an arbitrary element of the left set, and which is less equal by r naught and is less equal by minus f of y plus norm of f into norm of y plus x naught. Let me call this to be some inequality number 2. Okay. Inequality 1 we have given to that norm f naught is greater equal by norm of f. Okay, the reason, whatever is this discussion we have made till now, whatever the two arbitrary numbers we have taken, then we have added and subtracted a element vector x naught, then we have taken multiplication, then we have found supremas on the left, infimas on the right, then we have taken r naught is a number in between. All this discussion we have made in order to find this inequality, right? Now using this kind of inequality, we want to construct an arbitrary element of the set M naught. What is an arbitrary element of the set M naught? The nature we know, this is M plus alpha X naught. Therefore, here I want to just keep the value of Y as X by alpha. Some X by alpha. What will happen if I keep this as X by alpha here? If I keep X by alpha, if I have a cross multiplication, then the element we will obtain is X plus alpha X naught. That is some element in M naught. Okay. Therefore, let me just put Y is equal to X by alpha in above inequality. Therefore, this is minus F of X by alpha minus norm of F into norm of X by alpha plus X naught is less equal by R naught less equal by minus F of X by alpha plus norm of F into norm of X by alpha plus X naught. X by alpha plus X naught. And let me call this as inequality number 3. Okay. Now, the thing we are going to do is we are going to multiply the whole equation by a scalar alpha. But before multiplying, we should keep in the mind what will be a nature of alpha. Because if alpha is positive, there is no change in the inequality. But if alpha is negative, the inequalities are going to get reversed. Okay. Therefore, before multiplying by a scalar alpha, we will consider 3 subcases: alpha greater than 0, alpha equal to 0, alpha less than 0. Therefore, let me write subcase 1. What is subcase 1? Alpha greater than 0. Subcase 1, alpha greater than 0. Okay. And now in this alpha greater than 0, we will consider the right part of the inequality. What is the right part of the inequality? R naught is less equal by minus F of X by alpha plus norm of F into norm of X by alpha plus X naught. X by alpha plus X naught. Right. Now multiply by alpha on both the sides. We have R naught of alpha less than or equals to minus F of X. Okay. Before that, here you can use linearity property. If F is linear, that 1 by alpha is taken out and then we have to multiply. Okay. Just let me do those steps. Let me erase this part. Before multiplying directly by alpha, we will use the linearity property of F. What is the linearity property of F? Tells us the scalar 1 by alpha is taken out, F of X as it is, plus this norm F is also as it is. Now here we will multiply by a scalar alpha first, then this is norm of X plus alpha X naught, and the denominator will be alpha, which is a scalar, and that is taken out with a modulus. Therefore, this is mod of 1 by alpha. But as we are taking the value of alpha positive, mod of alpha will be 1 by alpha itself, right? Therefore, if it is 1 by alpha, now we will multiply by alpha. Therefore, now we can write R naught of alpha is less equal by minus F of X plus 1 by alpha is alpha, right? 1 by alpha is alpha. Modulus 1 by alpha is 1 by alpha. Therefore, this is norm of F, norm of X plus alpha X naught. Norm of X plus alpha X naught. Shifting this F of X on the left, we get this is F of X plus alpha R naught less equal by norm of F into X plus alpha X naught. X plus alpha X naught. Now look at this very carefully. What this is actually, this is a F naught image. This is F naught image of X plus alpha X naught. Okay. So let's just recall the definition of F naught we have defined initially. F naught of omega, where F naught is m plus alpha x naught, is defined as F of m plus alpha into r naught. Okay, therefore whenever we have F of m plus alpha r naught, this is F naught image of m plus alpha x naught. Therefore here we have F of x plus alpha r naught, therefore this is F naught image of x plus alpha x naught, and which is less equal by norm of F into norm of x plus alpha x naught, right? Now let me write x plus alpha x naught to be an arbitrary element in m naught, say W. Therefore F naught of W is less equal by norm of F into norm of omega. What we have assumed, W is x plus alpha x naught, which is an element of m naught, right? Therefore here we have obtained an inequality, F naught of omega is equals to norm F plus norm of W, norm F plus norm of W, right? Now we will go to subcase 2. What is subcase 2? Let me change the color. Here we have a facility to change the colors, no? Let us just use it. Therefore, let me write subcase 2. What is subcase 2? In subcase 1, we have seen alpha greater than 0. Now, in subcase 2, we will see alpha less than 0. Okay. If alpha is less than 0, we will use the left part of this inequality. Which left part of the inequality? This. Inequality number 3, we will use left part, right? For alpha greater than 0, we have made use of right part. Now, we will use left part for alpha less than 0. Okay. The inequality is minus F of x by alpha minus norm of F plus norm of x by alpha plus x naught, and is less equal by r naught. Now again here alpha, now we are considering a negative value. Again, use linearity. Let us make use of linearity of F. What is linearity of L? F tells us this is minus 1 by alpha F of X minus norm of alpha, multiplying by alpha here. This is of the type X plus alpha X naught. This scalar is taken out with the modulus. Therefore, this is modulus 1 by alpha less than or equals to r naught. But as alpha is negative, alpha less than 0, 1 by alpha is also less than 0. Therefore, mod of 1 by alpha is, what is the value of mod of 1 by alpha? Mod of 1 by alpha is minus 1 by alpha. We will keep the value here and we get it as minus 1 by alpha F of X. Now this is mod 1 by alpha is minus 1 by alpha. Therefore this becomes positive. This is positive norm of F 1 by alpha norm of X plus alpha X naught less than or equals to R naught. Now we will multiply throughout by alpha, and as alpha negative, inequality less equal will get reversed to greater equal. Therefore this we can write as minus F of X plus norm of F into norm of X plus alpha X naught is greater equal by alpha R naught. Why the inequality was reversed? Because alpha negative and we have multiplied by alpha. Therefore this is kind of the inequality we have obtained. And just repeat the same step as of the previous subcase. Therefore this is norm F. This I am shifting on the right. This is norm F. Norm of X plus alpha x naught is greater equal by alpha r naught plus f of x. Again, just have a look. F of x plus alpha r naught is f naught image of x plus alpha x naught. Okay. Therefore, on the right left we have norm f is into norm of x plus alpha x naught. Okay, assuming this number is again by w, this we can write as norm of f into norm of w is greater equal by f naught of w. The assumption w is x plus alpha x naught is an element of say m naught. Therefore, just let me write the inequality by reversing. If this is f naught of omega is less equal by norm of f into norm of omega. Norm of f into norm of omega. Okay. Therefore, see, in subcase 1 also, we have obtained the same kind of inequality. F naught of omega is less equal by norm f into norm of omega. And in subcase 2, same inequality. F naught of omega is less equal by norm f into norm of omega. Now, we will go for third subcase. That is equal to 0. What will be my third subcase? Alpha equal to 0 gives us. In alpha equals to 0, this is very easy to define, because in step 2, we have proved that f naught is equal to f on m. Rather, it is an extension. Okay, and this is obtained by alpha is equal to 0. Therefore, whenever we have alpha is equal to 0, f naught is equal to f. We can check it. F naught of m plus alpha x naught. Now let me put alpha 0. Therefore, this is f naught of m plus 0 x naught. Therefore, f naught of m plus 0 x naught is f naught of m. And for the elements of f naught, it is f itself. Therefore, this is f naught of m is equal to f of m. Right? That is f naught is equal to f. And if both the functions are equal, may I easily say here that norm f naught is equal to norm f is true. Or rather, it is obviously true in the third subcase. Therefore, nothing to worry about the third subcase of alpha equals to 0. The only thing to prove about is for alpha less than 0 and for alpha greater than 0. Right? Therefore, let us continue by alpha. Let me call those as equation number some 3 and 4. No? I think up to 3 we have came. Yes, this is say 4. And from subcase 2, same we have obtained. Therefore, let me call this as 5. Now, from 4 and 5, what we have observed? From 4 and 5, we have obtained mod of f naught of w is less equal by norm of f into norm of w. Now let us check what will happen if we replace this value. This is not modulus. This is f naught of omega simply. F naught of w simply. Now we will replace this w by minus w. What will happen if I replace w by minus w? The inequality will be f naught of minus w is less equal by norm of f into norm of minus w. What is the effect on the left? F naught is linear, therefore that scalar minus w is actually minus 1 into w. Therefore, minus 1 is the scalar taken out. Therefore, one can write as minus f naught of w less equal by norm of f. What is the norm value of minus w? Minus 1 is the scalar used, taken out with the modulus. Modulus minus 1 is plus 1. Therefore, there is no effect on the right. Therefore, this is norm f into norm of w. Now, look at these two inequalities. This one and this one. Therefore, what kind of inequality we have obtained? Let me just insert the pages. Okay, therefore the inequality we have obtained is of this type. X less equal by A minus X is less than or equal by A. Therefore, together we will write mod X is less than or equals to A. mod x is less than or equal to. Therefore, combining these two inequalities, may I write mod of f naught of w is less equal by norm f into norm of w. Norm f into norm of w. Now here, since f is bounded, this is fixed value, and here we have shown that f naught of w is less equal by some fixed constant into norm of w. Therefore, may I say here we have obtained f naught is bounded. F naught is linear, we have proved in the claim number one. Now we have proved f naught is bounded. Therefore, now may I say f naught becomes a functional. F naught is a functional on m naught. F naught becomes a functional on m naught. Now it remains to prove norm f naught is equals to norm f. That is the right part of the inequality. It remains to prove. For this, let me start with the operator norm definition. Norm f naught is equals to supremum. What is the definition? Mod f naught of w on the condition w belongs to m naught, provided norm w is less than or equals to 1. Norm w is less than or equals to 1. Okay. Again, why it is modulus? Because f naught is a scalar valued function, either real or complex. That's why the norm acting on the spaces is modulus. Therefore, this is modulus, supremum mod f naught of w. But just now we have proved mod f naught of w is less equal by norm f into norm w. Therefore, may I write this as supremum norm f into norm of w. Rest things as it is. Now, what this is, if I put norm w is less than or equals to 1 here, what we have obtained? The suprema or the set depends on w. I'm keeping the value of w as norm w is less than or equals to 1. So for here, we obtain simply less than or equals to norm of f. Therefore, we have proved the inequality norm f naught is less than or equals to norm of f. Let me call this as inequality number 6. In inequality 1, we have proved norm f naught is greater equal by norm f. And thus, combining both, we have norm f is equal to norm of f naught. And hence, this is the proof of first part, that is for real valued linear spaces. Still, it remains to prove for complex valued linear spaces. Okay. How many steps we have verified in this proof? We have first defined f naught by using the definition of f itself. First claim, we have proved f naught linear. In the second claim, we have proved f naught is an extension of f by proving f naught is equals to f on m. In the third step, norm f naught is equals to norm f. While proving this, in between, we have proved f naught is bounded. Thus, we have proved f naught is linear, bounded, scalar valued, as well as norm f is equals to norm of f naught. Means all the parts given in the proof are verified for the real linear spaces. Now let us come to the next part of this proof, that is step number 2. In this step, we should consider this for complex spaces. We should consider this for complex. Therefore, let me write step number 2. Considering the field K is equal to field of complex number. Therefore, what is the assumption? N is complex normed linear space. N is complex normed linear space. And F is complex valued functional. Complex valued functional. Okay. Therefore, f is now defined from n to c. N to c. Okay. Therefore, f is a complex valued functional defined on m. Na? M, which is a subspace of n. Now, we know that every complex valued function is defined with the help. Sorry, here it is m. Defined on m. Na? Now we know that f is a complex valued function which can be defined with the help of two real valued functional. Therefore, in this proof, we are going to follow the same thing. That is, we will write a complex valued functional as this g of I plus h, where g and h are real valued functionals defined on a real linear space. Yeah. Therefore, we can write f of x is equal to g of x plus I h of x for all x in M, for all x in M, where g and h are real valued functionals on real linear space. Here we will consider as real linear subspace. Okay, why we are considering real linear space? Because M is a subspace of N. Okay, and therefore this N is defined on complex. Therefore, I am considering M to be a real linear subspace. Right. Now, if someone wants to understand how this G and H are real valued functionals, then we must prove that those are real. Those are going to satisfy all the conditions of functional, that is linear, bounded as well. Okay, I am not going to include that proof in the theorem. If we want, I can give you the proof in the next lecture, because already the proof is somewhat lengthy. Therefore, I don't want to make it more lengthy. Okay, therefore now we will start with f of x we have defined as g of x plus I h of x. Now what will happen if I write f of I x? What will happen if I write f of I x? F of I x will be g of I x plus I h of I x. F of I x is g of I x plus I h of I x. Therefore, may I write this as I g of x? Why? I is a scalar from a complex field, and g is a linear functional. Therefore, this scalar we have taken out. Therefore, this is I g of x. Same thing we will do here. This is I h of x, right? Therefore, one can write this as I g of x. Here I into I square. I square is minus 1. Therefore, this is minus h of x, right? Therefore, let me write it as minus h of x plus I g of x. To the left side, what can I write this as? G of I x plus I h of I x. Though a term I x is involved, g is a real valued functional. Therefore, comparing real and imaginary parts, therefore this is g of I x is nothing but minus h of x, and h of I x is nothing but g of x. Okay, now this we are doing just in order to express the function in terms of one function, either g or h. Okay, therefore hence f of I x or f of x is equal to what we have written initially, g of x plus I h of x. Now this h of x we will replace by this g. Therefore, may I write this as g of x minus I g of I x. I g of I x. Is that clear? Therefore, f of x we have obtained in terms of one real valued functional g. Okay, instead of dealing with the two real valued functional, it could be easier for us if we deal with only one real valued functional. Okay, therefore what is g? G is a real valued functional. G is a real valued functional defined on M. Okay, what is M? M is the real space. M is the real space. But this situation we have proved in step one, no? That a real valued functional defined on M can be extended to a functional on M. Now, okay, Therefore, here may I write by case one. By case one, by case one, G can be extended. G can be extended to a real valued functional say G naught. In last lecture we have extended f to f naught, no? Therefore here let us extend it to G naught on m naught. Okay, how? Such that norm of G is equal to norm of G naught. Norm of G is equals to norm of G naught. Now what is our aim? To prove that f is extended to a functional. Therefore here we will try to define f naught as. How can I define f naught? G is a function extended to g naught. Therefore, may I write g naught of x. This g is extended to g naught. Therefore, this is minus I g naught of ix. This is what we will define as f naught, and we will prove that this is a functional on m naught. Okay, this is the functional on m naught. Now, in order to prove that this is a functional on m naught, how many things to prove? How many things we should prove? First thing, f naught is linear on m naught. This is complex space. This is a complex space, right? Second thing, we have to prove that f naught is an extension of f. Therefore, f naught is equals to f on m. Third thing we will prove, norm of f naught is equal to norm of f, right? Norm of f naught is equals to norm of f. Let us go one by one. First step, I will prove that f naught is linear. F naught is linear. Now, as the scalars under the consideration are the complex number, therefore instead of considering the linear combination directly, we will prove that f naught preserves addition and scalar multiplication separately. Therefore, let me just first write for an addition. F naught of x plus y. According to definition, this is g naught of x plus y minus I g naught of I times x plus y. That is I x plus I y. Okay, just recall that. I'm just using this definition. F naught of x is g naught of x minus I g naught of I x. Okay. Let us use the definition, just separate the elements. G naught is a functional, therefore this is linear. Therefore this is G naught of x plus G naught of y minus I times, this is G naught of ix minus I times G naught of iy. Okay, next step, this is G naught of x plus, now let me take x terms together. Therefore this is I G naught of ix, I'll write. G naught of ix minus I G naught of ix in one bracket added with G naught of y minus I G naught of iy in another bracket. Okay. Then this is G naught of ix, G naught of x plus I G naught of ix is nothing but f naught of x, and this is nothing but f naught of y. Hence f naught is going to preserve addition. And now we will prove a scalar multiplication. Therefore, f naught, the scalar used is a complex number. Let me write it as some a plus ib into x. What the definition says? This is g naught of ax plus ibx. I'll just multiply first. Multiplying by x here. Minus I g naught of I a plus ib times x. Okay. Now, let us use linearity. I'll write from this state. Okay. Therefore, this is g naught is linear because it is a functional. Therefore, this is a g naught of x plus b g naught of ix minus. If I multiply in a bracket, in the bracket itself, what will happen if I multiply by x? This is IEAX, and I n to I square is minus 1, therefore this is minus bx plus ix. These are some steps, some algebraic steps, nothing to worry about these steps. A g naught of x plus b g naught of ix. Okay, now multiply by I using linearity again. The first step, this is I g naught of minus bx. I want to take minus b out. If I take minus b out, this will be plus I b g naught of x plus I b g naught of x. Next step, now what I will do? I will just take I a out, not I a, this is a out. If I take a out, what will happen? This is minus I a. How many things remaining? A I am taking out, therefore this is I x remaining, right? Now let us take these two terms together. Let us take these two terms. G naught of x will be common from both. If I take these two terms to these two terms together, g naught of x will be common, and we will remain with the bracketed terms as a plus ib into g naught of x. Okay. Similarly, from the remaining two, this is b minus ia into g naught of ix. Okay. Now what I will do? I just want to adjust this as a plus ib. How can I do? Okay, if I want to adjust it as a plus ib, I will take minus I common. This is minus I is taken common. You may check. This is minus ia, this term. Second term is minus I square, that is plus 1b. Right? Therefore, this is g naught into ix. Next, now I'll take the scalar common, a plus ib, complex scalar. And the terms remaining with us will be g naught of ax minus I g naught of ix. Therefore, may I say f naught is linear. Here the left side is f naught of a plus ib into x equal to this we have proved. And for means this is going to preserve the operation of scalar multiplication. Okay. Therefore, may I say f naught is linear on m naught. F naught is linear on m naught. Next step, we will go for proving f naught is equals to f on m. For again, consider f naught of m. How m can be written as an element of m naught? This is m plus 0 into x naught. What is the definition? This is g naught of m minus I g naught of im, right? Therefore, what is g naught of m? G naught is an extension of g. Therefore, g naught is equals to g on m. Therefore, this is g naught is equals to g. I will write this is minus I g of im, and this is nothing but f of m. Okay. Therefore, we have proved f naught is equals to f on m. F naught is equals to f on m. This will be video will be quite bigger because I don't want to divide the proof into 2-3 lectures. Already we have divided into 2 parts. Okay, just bear with me. In the third step, we will prove that norm f naught is equal to norm of f. And in this only f naught is bounded will be proved. Therefore, no need to prove that step separately. In the last case step also, we have done the same thing. Therefore, let us start with an element x in m naught. Therefore, we will define a mapping. F naught on m naught to C. Right? Therefore, f naught of x can be written as, what is the number, resulting number? It's a complex value. And we know that every complex value can be written with this format, r into e raised to I theta, because f naught image is a complex number. Every complex number we can write with this, where r is an argument and r is a modulus, theta is an argument. Therefore, here may I write r is greater or equal by 0 and theta is real. R is greater or equal by 0 and theta is real. Therefore, what is mod f naught of x? Mod f naught of x is equal to r. Right. Now, can I write this r by adjusting e raised to plus theta and e raised to minus theta? Okay. Therefore, may I write this as e raised to minus theta into f naught of x. Okay. And e raised to minus I theta is a complex scalar. Therefore, knowing f naught is linear, may I write this as f naught of e raised to minus I theta into x. Therefore, r is equals to what we have obtained. R is equals to f naught of e raised to minus I theta into x. Therefore, may I write r is equals to g naught. The previous definition, f naught of x is g naught of x minus I g naught of I x. Therefore, this is e raised to minus I theta into x minus I g naught of I e raised to minus I theta into x. Now, equating real and imaginary part, g naught is a real valued functional. Therefore, the first term is equated. Therefore, r is equals to g naught of e raised to minus I theta into x. Equating real and imaginary parts. Equating real and imaginary parts. What is the reason? Since g naught is real valued functional. Since g naught is real valued functional, right? Therefore, what I'm getting, r is equals to g naught of e raised to I theta. But as g naught is real valued functional, may I say g naught is bounded? And if it is bounded, may I write r is equals to g naught of e raised to minus I theta into x is less equal by norm of g naught into norm of e raised to minus I theta into x. Here I can write the modulus also. Right, modulus. Modulus I raised to I theta. I'll just increase the pages. Right, therefore, may I say norm this r is less equal by norm g naught into. Now, this is a scalar involved in the norm, and we know the scalar is always taken out with a modulus. Therefore, e raised to minus I theta into norm of x. But what is the value? E raised to minus I theta modulus is always 1, because e raised to minus I theta is, yes, what is the value? This is cos theta minus I sin theta. And if I take a modulus, this is under root cos square theta plus sin square theta, and that is always 1. Therefore, here we got r is less than or equals to norm of g naught into norm of x, but r is mod of f naught of x. Initially, we have taken this less than or equals to norm of g naught into norm of x. Therefore, here we have obtained norm f naught of x is less equal by some fixed constant into norm of x. Therefore, here I can say that f naught is bounded. F naught is bounded. Okay. And here this is equal to norm g into norm of x, because by step 1, g is extended to a functional g naught with norm values are same. Further, I can say norm g is less than or equals to norm of f. Why? Because f we have written g plus ih. Therefore, clearly, norm g is less than or equals to norm of f. This will be equal if h is equals to 0. But if h is equals to 0, that would be a real valued functional. But we are in the situation of complex valued functional. Therefore, norm g is less than or equals to norm f. Therefore, let us look at this condition again. Here I will replace norm g is less equal by norm of f. Therefore, we got it as mod of f naught of x less than or equals to norm of f into norm of x. Right. Now let us use the definition of supremum noun. Use definition of operator nor. What is the definition of operator nor? How can we find norm of f naught? Norm of f naught is supremum mod of f naught of x. X belongs to the underlying field and norm x is less than or equals to 1. But just now we have written mod f naught of x is less than or equals to norm f into, therefore this is less than or equals to supremum norm f into norm of x with the conditions. Now let us put norm x is less than or equals to 1, therefore this gives us norm of f. Therefore we have proved norm f naught is less than or equals to norm of f. Let me call this as inequality number 1, and norm f naught is greater equal by norm of f as proved in step 1. Hence we have proved norm f naught is equal to norm of f. Hence we have completed the proof of Hahn-Banach-Lehmann. I'll just tell you quickly how this is going to work out. Okay, this is a subspace M, x not be a point not in M, and this is a non-linear space N. Then one is going to form a linear subspace spanned by M and x not. We will call it as say M not. Okay, then any real valued functional defined on F is now extended to a linear functional f naught on M with norm values are same. That is norm f is equals to norm of f naught. Hence, we have completed the Hahn-Banach-Lehmann. Though the proof is quite lengthy but not difficult, we just go through the proof of this Hahn-Banach-Lehmann. In the next lecture, we will go to Hahn-Banach theorem. Thank you for watching today's lecture.